Okay, let's get started. What we did in the introductory session in the morning was to give an overview. Mainly we focused on why learner centric. All of you gave some responses related to student engagement, students learning and so on. And we talked a little bit about the elements of a learner centric MOOC. So now, right now, what the role that you want to think of yourselves in is you want to design a learner centric MOOC. Okay, you may not need to design the entire MOOC, so don't get daunted that, oh, I have to do the whole thing. But assume you want to create one module, one topic you want to create in a learner-centric MOOC fashion. By the end of this session, what we'll do is take your content or your lesson plans, your syllabus from what you've brought, and we'll do a longish activity which will continue across lunch on making a learner-centric MOOC out of one topic of that. That's the main goal today. So you're at the stage now where you're ready to dive in planning. Today we are not going to do anything like shoot videos, create videos and all, but you're going to think of from the content perspective, from your learner's perspective, and start the planning. Okay, so like with any course design, this comes with a set of questions, decisions and tasks that you have to do. So the first question you need to think about is you're in the role where you're designing a new course on a topic that's very comfortable, you're familiar with, but you haven't designed a course. Maybe you've taught it in some other fashion, but you're designing a new course. What are the different tasks you need to do in order to plan this course? Doesn't have to be in order, just write down a long list. So I'm going to stop at in 1 minute. Okay, so the way we'll do it is, we'll take one from this side, one from this side. I want to actually write down your responses here, so I won't be looking up too much. Say one thing and pass on the mic to your neighbor and make sure you go alternate one by one. So let's start from this side. 1 second. Take the mic when you speak, okay?
Okay, so while planning the new course, we need the lesson plan.
You need a lesson plan.
Then,
okay. Next person.
First of all, you have to have course outcomes.
Course outcomes. Plan or decide course. 1 second.
The next is learning outcomes. Objectives. Videos.
Create. Okay. Design. Create. Videos. One from this side.
Breaking the syllabus into smaller units.
So consider taking the video and identifying small pieces, small blocks of information in your content. So identify blocks of info in syllabus. Okay, from this side.
Activities like project, quiz.
Yeah, design, plan, design activities, project.
Level, that is UG or PG, like that.
Ah, okay. At which level course is. Activities. If you've already seen things here, so projects, classroom activities.
Taking surveys from students.
Survey from students for what reason?
Their qualifications and topics.
Get to know students' background.
Yeah.
Will that work? Okay.
Real-time examples.
What do you mean by real-time examples?
Once you have learned this topic, you can able to implement this or...
Real life, okay, real, okay.
Real life applications.
Real life examples.
Outcome of this particular.
Okay.
Prerequisites for the course?
Decide prerequisites, yes. Decide prerequisites.
Interactive sessions with the students.
So teachers interacting with students?
Students.
Okay, so teachers interacting with students.
Hands-on experience, some lab or experimentations required.
So let's put it separately. So design, lab, on. Decide duration. So let's end with this one. The reason we want to end with this one is because I have a list of categories on the next page which actually starts with the duration. Okay, so this just looks like a long list of text here. What we want to do is take what you said and see if it fits in some place here. I'm going to go to this mode itself. So decide duration. This is something you have to decide fairly early on. This is also not in precise order, but it's roughly the order that you'll follow. You may have to iterate a little bit back and forth. So there is something that we call as scoping. Okay. By scoping, you have to decide size of your course, the length of your course, how deep or broad your content should be, and you start by saying, who are the learners? So let's look at the points here and see which ones related to scoping. Course objectives and all, we had talked about objectives also. Get to know students' background, this one, and there was one. At which level is this course at UGPG? Lesson plan is not something you do right now. Lesson plan comes much, much, much later. By lesson plan, I'm assuming a day-wise what you'll do in tomorrow's class. Okay, hold on to that. That doesn't come right now. You haven't even started planning what to teach and how to teach yet. Okay, all right. So this is what is meant by scoping. If any of these points are unclear as we go through, you can ask. Then we come to every instructor's favorite item, content. What topics, which subtopics, at what breadth, at what depth, and so on. Right? I think that there's no need to do any mapping. Then there's a bunch of things about how am I going to teach it? What activities will I give? Yeah, so let's look at the previous slide. Design and create videos is going to come in the next one where you're actually creating materials. Before you create materials, you want to actually have an idea of what to teach and how to teach. You have to have a rough strategy or rough plan. So any other planning strategy thing that you see here? Design activities to some extent. Decide that you need a lab or hands-on, right? So those are all in your planning of your activities. And then once you know what to teach and how to teach, once you have a rough idea, you dive into creating your materials. So when we say materials, now somebody had said videos earlier. What other materials? You can think of a face-to-face class also. Actually, that's something we're more comfortable with. What presentations I'll do in class? What will I lecture about? What else? TPS in class. You have to design the TPS, the activities for the class. TPS, PI, the classroom activities, the whole thing you have to, so you have to design the information content, the student activities, and pretty soon you start thinking about homework and assignments. What homework will I design and give students? What assignments? What projects? Out of class. Okay. And when you're doing that, let's put assessment also with it. We'll come to resources in a minute. Assessment also is similar to homework. We saw that in the previous session. Because this is something you're thinking of from the student's perspective. What questions to ask them? There is something missing here. When you talk of assignments and assessment, there is something that's not there on the slide. Okay, you create questions. Students go and do the assignment. What happens after that? You have to give feedback. Okay, so feedback has to come somewhere here. It got missed. Feedback. Even here, you have to give feedback. And while doing all of this, while or a little later or so, you ask, what is the infrastructure available? Like, is it a face-to-face class? Is there a projector? Is there a chalk and board? If I want to play a video, do I have a laptop? Infrastructure, you also have to ask about technology and human resources. Some of you may have TAs. Do I have some support? All these things are there in your course decision. Anything major thing we've missed in this? Okay, so these are sort of the tasks and decisions we have to do. And let's actually go through this here and try, if you see your entry, see where it maps. Okay, onto the next slide. Okay, so now if we move from general course design, course planning, to a learner-centric MOOC planning, there are many of the tasks are similar, but there are a few key differences. One is that you'll need some adaptation of these tasks. The answers you will give for a face-to-face class may be slightly different than the answers you will give for a MOOC class. So that's what's meant by adaptation. You may need to change some of your answers. The second key difference is that there may be some additional tasks that come because of the MOOC setting. So in what way is the MOOC setting different than a face-to-face setting?
Doubts after receiving the answer from the students to remove the misconception.
So you have to clear doubts. That's there in a face-to-face setting also. That's an important point you do, but that's there in both settings. So the question I'm asking is, here it says there are differences due to MOOC setting. We're just taking that. What is different between a MOOC setting and your face-to-face setting? So the way you want to think about this is you can actually imagine. Think of your students. So there is a time difference with respect to synchronicity or time. That's one difference. In a MOOC, it may be more asynchronous, right? What are other differences? Yes?
In face-to-face settings, we can always make sure that people are thinking, discussing, replying. But in MOOCs, we may have to have some mechanism like quizzes and so on. So to ensure that students are involved actually, otherwise they just keep the video on and they're not
involved. This difference is coming due to the distance. In a face-to-face class, you see them right in front. Here, you don't see them. They're at a distance. You see some login, but on the other hand, the visibility or the tangibility of these learners is not as high in the MOOC setting. So there's a difference in terms of time, in terms of distance, and that's why this point is very important, what you mentioned. We'll come to it later. Other differences, yeah.
Give feedback at regular interval, that congratulation or means he has to give good feedback.
Okay.
That if you have completed this assignment or...
So because of the synchronicity problem, I'm just going, or issue, and because of the distance issue, we have to ensure that students are on task and we have to give feedback to make sure that they got it. There is one more difference actually, which, number, scale, yes, the scale is a huge difference. It's a very obvious one. It's massive open online course. But even if you had a small online course, first two issues may exist. In addition to scale, there's one more issue, and that comes with this point of who are your learners. So let's spend a little bit of time in it. In a face-to-face class, what do you know about your learners?
Their behavior, their intensity of learning.
Okay, you know their behavior and all, but let's say before your first class, I'm going to make it even more specific. Before your first class, what all do you know about your learners? You know their previous background because they've all, so if you are teaching a third year first semester course, they've all finished second year semester, you know which courses they've taken. You may also know their grades in those courses if you're in a college. They're all from the same domain. They're all in the mechanical engineering third year course. So it's likely, not exactly, but it's possible that they're all there for a similar set of reasons. They're all third year, first semester courses. So just imagine them. What else can you say about them? Their age, more or less similar. They're all in the, 18 to 20 background.
And the student's body language you see, and they're nodding their heads or not understanding, they're able to grasp it. So on MOOC, we cannot...
MOOC, you can't see it. So the invisibility problem is there. Absolutely. Yeah, that's slightly different from thinking about the learner characteristics. Learner characteristics means who are they? What are their backgrounds? Why are they here? So why are your third year students there in your class? What's their motivation to be in your class? To pass the exam so that they get their degree, at least that much. Yeah. If they don't pass the exam, they won't get their degree. So you know all of them are there at least to get the degree. And there may be other reasons also. So what happens in a MOOC is, MOOC learners are very different than face-to-face students because, and they're diverse in many ways. They may not be all of the same age. They may not be there to pass the exam to get a degree. Some of them may be working professionals who have come back to relearn something, update their knowledge. Some of them may just want to check out. They may be an artist who wants to see, oh, what is programming? Let me go and see. They may just be, you know, trying to sample different courses. What else might, in what other ways are MOOC learners different than face-to-face learners? Yeah.
In MOOCs, most of the students are interested about the topic. That's why they are registering for the course.
So let's examine that. You may assume that most people are...
In regular classroom, students have to sit for the class because it is compulsory.
Okay, so that actually goes both ways. A lot of learners register for your MOOC. So we tend to assume that, it's because they're interested in my course. Typical standard MOOCs, traditional MOOCs, the completion percentage, which means they have done some 30% of the assignments. The completion percentage is 6 to 10%. So out of a few thousands or a few hundred thousand people who register, 6% of them complete it. It's that bad.
Once they have paid some money, they are about 50% or 60%.
So we are talking of the open or the open in both sense. The ones which have a certification where they pay money for, the pass percentage is likely to be higher. Okay, so MOOC learners are different in many other ways. So the diversity, the word that we hadn't encountered so far is diversity. Time, distance, scale, and diversity. And diverse in many, many, many ways, including their motivation, why they're here, what they want to get out of the MOOC, and so on. So given this diversity, we come back to what your course should be about. And here there are some recommendations. The main recommendation is make your scope focused. So state prerequisites so that everybody knows upfront exactly what they can get out of the course. It's not sufficient to say that this is a course on programming. It's not even sufficient to say that this is a course on C programming, or to say here we will learn about arrays, topics B and topic C. But you want this learner, the person who's going to register, wants to know whether she will get to write some programs or whether she'll just learn these concepts. Whether there'll be applications discussed of programming in a particular field or in some other field. Which type of examples are you going to talk about? So all this, it's worthwhile stating in your scope. Which means you have to decide it, which means you have to think of the whole range. So the scoping is something which is we have to take ownership of, as in we have to take responsibility to write as a MOOC designer. In a face-to-face class, most of it is there in the syllabus, and you just give some examples. Yeah. So this is one key thing you have to do in the beginning. Along with it, state what is not in your scope. So if you're not going to discuss applications in a particular field, don't say. Examples will only be restricted to some two fields. Any examples you can think of?
I announced a course on animation, 3D animation. And the popular perception about animation course is immediately related to cartoons. And one thing which was completely out of scope for my course was that I am not going to talk about character animation at all. But this was a basic course. So I had to write it very specifically. And then I saw that a lot of people who actually came had dropped out after that. But that is easy to handle rather than keeping them expecting that something will come up and not delivering that. So this is very important, especially when you write a sentence in your own visualization, you think about it that people should understand it like that and it doesn't happen. So this writing explicit out of scope helps a lot. So then it is very clear to people about this.
Okay, moving along. Still, we're still at scope. So you have stated the scope, and then think about the objectives of the MOOC. So it may not be very specific learning objectives, topic by topic, but at a broad level, the course outcomes. What are the course outcomes? Here, there are key recommendations. Don't choose many varied objectives, which means let the objectives also be coherent, and let there be a few coherent objectives rather than having one objective related to something, one here and one there. And these focused objectives should be aligned to the chosen scope. Why? Why is this recommendation given in a MOOC? Connect back to the...
For easy understanding.
Okay, for easy understanding, that is true. That's true even in a class, right? Yeah, it's valid. But what is so special about a MOOC? What is special about the learners in a MOOC?
Relevance,
and we're back to diversity. If your learners are so diverse and you've already scoped them, I mean, you're saying that I want learners of this type. So make sure that your objectives also are aligned towards those learners. Yeah? Okay, there is another reason. What should be the duration of a MOOC? So here, the recommendation is that it should be short. So the 2 to 4 weeks, you'll see some 6 week ones perhaps. You'll see some 1 week MOOCs also. But this is shorter than your face-to-face semester long or God forbid year long course. Why? Why means what are the problems that might happen if the MOOC is long? And some of you told me the problems over chai. People don't continue, it's known. Long MOOCs, people drop out a lot. And one reason they may drop out is because of this lack of engagement may stem from distance and not being lack of personalization. The other, so this short has implication that you have, it goes back to the previous scoping. You have to have a very narrow, tight, focused scope. Okay? One big implication here is that if you're designing a MOOC, you can't take your college level course and say, I'm going to create one MOOC out of that college level course. Your college level course is too big for a single MOOC. So instead, the recommendation is consider designing multiple MOOCs, each on a chosen subset of topics.
Suppose the course is not available to his university or college, so to a specialized topic. Suppose I am working in a college or I am a student in a college in Calcutta, and in a particular topic which is not available, teacher is not available, and the course is taught in MIT or Harvard or IIT Bombay, then I will keep interest on that topic to register the course because this is not available easily at my place. That's why I am registering for a MOOCs.
Okay.
And for a classical topic which is easily available to me, then I can see some videos and lots of content are available on internet. So I will be not interested in these MOOCs. So if it is concentrated on the specialized topic, which is more advanced and recent topic, then lots of students will be interested.
Okay, so let's take 2 points here. One is on what topic do you create your MOOC? One possibility, as you said, is if the MOOC is unique in terms of topic, you may have larger number of people who may take it. But along with uniqueness, there is also the issue of relevance. You may say that there exists so many courses on programming, but there is none on programming for poets. And I have a lot of poets in my class. I'm giving an extreme example. And poets need to know programming because of that. So if you want to make things relevant for the learners you think of, that's also a valid reason. Okay? Of course, so now back to, should I create a MOOC, a massive open online course right away? And here the recommendation is create a learner-centric online module first. Test it out. Maybe you have a Moodle in your course, test it out on Moodle. Then see if how many people are interested, if they want to take it, what changes you have to make, and only then consider going to the massive. And in our group, even though we have had a lot of experience creating MOOCs, this is exactly the model we follow. It takes us about 3 years to reach a MOOC. We do small face-to-face workshops, then a slightly larger online course, and then the MOOC. So that's sort of required. So overall, and yeah, the other point I wanted to make is just because a lot of people register in a MOOC does not mean they'll complete, okay? That's something you have to keep in mind. Okay, so scoping, the main summary recommendations are get to know who your learners are because you need to tailor examples, you need to customize feedback, personalize the MOOC because of distance issues and diversity issues. Focus your scope based on some criteria and choose your objectives, duration, and content accordingly. This is the takeaway message with respect to scoping. Any questions at this point before we move to next part of course design? Comments, questions there and then there.
I just had a question regarding duration. So actually, if you see many of the MOOCs, they are self-paced. Okay. And some of them are having deadlines for every activity. Now, if you see, I mean, obviously, that's with respect to the objectives and relevance of the and the diversity of the learners also. But the question is, you know, each side has got pros and cons.
That's true.
So when you decide that whether we should go for a self-paced MOOC or should we go for a, you know, in terms of, we are now talking about conceptualizing.
The deadline.
Yeah. So what should be the ideal strategy to go for? Should we have mixture of both? Or should we go only for a full self-paced because freedom is there? But then when freedom is there, we feel that
चलो बाद में कर लेंगे, लेट्स सी, वी हैव लॉट ऑफ टाइम येट, एंड देन यू नो थिंग्स गेट गो ऑन गेटिंग स्टैगर्ड. सो व्हाट डू यू सजेस्ट इन टर्म्स ऑफ स्ट्रेटजी, इन टर्म्स ऑफ ड्यूरेशन?
Yeah, so to be, yeah, disclaimer is that we haven't run a self-paced MOOC yet, correct?
We have.
You have, okay.
No, so, because we are talking about conceptualizing a MOOC, so I just thought if you could just give us some insights on that.
Yeah.
So there are two points here. One is how do you visualize that part of MOOC where you want maximum people to perform at the same time? But this being a technology affordance, which doesn't happen in a class. In a class, everybody submits homework at a time and the course gets finished at a time. Why we have shifted our delivery method to a MOOC is primarily because we want to make it available to a larger audience who are interested in knowing certain things, right, as knowledge upgradation or whatever. Now, if we are giving that facility for them to do that, then our design or our scope or plan should be able to accommodate such points. So there is no dependency that if they don't submit by first week, nothing bad is going to happen. So if that is thought in the plan itself, then such problems never occur. But if there is a dependency, like in our FDPs, suppose a peer interaction is based on other two should submit. Now I submitted mine and none of them came up to submit theirs, then I am stuck because of others. So such a model has to be worked out in a different manner at times because you are doing it in the self-paced. So there are pros and cons of instructor-based versus self-paced, but that decision is dominated mostly for me by the content of the MOOC.
So and if by it the is goal, a, right? By the top-level goal. So if it's a self-paced MOOC, your goal may be different than if you do a MOOC where you need learners to interact with each other.
The difference between a first difference is between a curricular MOOC or a informative kind of MOOC. So that is first level. But even in self-paced, you can have like long spaces, like give 10 days for submission or so I did a self-paced MOOC, by the way, but there were three quizzes. So they should clear three quizzes in order to finish the MOOC. But the quizzes were not released at the same time, not at the beginning of the course. So what I did, I released first quiz after first month. So I waited for people to finish that. And then when there were some queries, sir, when is the second quiz coming? Then I put the second quiz because now I have enough generated enough interest in the mind of people. Okay, now they are ready to do that. Then I release the second quiz. And then I release next set of new assignments. So that actually goes as an email to everybody that new assignments are released, new quizzes coming up. That just helps me in retention of my people. So it's a strategy decision how you want to take it up, even if it is a non-curricular MOOC. And even if they don't attempt assignment, nothing bad is going to happen. But still, design is important here. And what content are you trying to do? So if it is a curricular and rest of the exams are going to come on that day and you don't have, you haven't completed anything, then you are in a problem. So depends a lot. I have seen edX MOOCs which are running for a year. So if there is a year-long MOOC and I am not going to take anything after maybe first week, then always these kind of things are going to happen.
Okay, all right. So this was the main thing with respect to the scoping. Okay, this is the first thing. We'll keep coming back to the scope because this is going to drive a lot of your decisions. Okay, then if you go back to course planning, there's this whole thing about materials, creating the materials, choosing the media and so on. What topics, subtopics and all come sort of come in the scope, they'll come back again in the materials. And so this is what to teach and how to teach and the materials you create for it. So when you're doing this one, there are some principles to keep in mind, some key principles. So in the morning we said that there are some principles, this is where we get into the principles. So again we'll look at a few scenarios here and see what's wrong with the scenario or will that scenario work in a different way, and then from there we'll discuss the principles. So the first scenario is that your colleague believes that his course can be converted to a MOOC by simply capturing lecture videos, his lecture videos, and making them available to students along with some activities and assessment. Okay. Do you agree with this statement that a MOOC is capturing of lecture videos, making them available to students, and then maybe some activities? Yes? No? Come on, everybody has to vote, so I'm going to make. Okay. So, looks like I heard a larger no and larger hands and some I don't knows. So let's look at this a little more deeply. Write down one negative effect if suppose you follow your colleague's model. What bad thing might happen? What more bad things may happen? Talk to your colleague. This is mostly about trying to analyze why this model is unlikely to be effective. Okay, share your reasons, like the top two or three reasons, one by one, okay? Just why do you think, or what are the negative effects that might happen if you follow your colleague? I heard a lot of you copying, you know, in what, so you're saying that some students might game the system.
If you do, give answers for all activities.
Yeah, if you give all activities together, the students might just answer them. Okay, yes. It may be monotonous, okay, if you just capture the lecture videos. Others?
Difficult to retain the students' concentration.
Students' attention, students' engagement is difficult to retain. One more.
There's no collaboration.
There may be no collaboration, yes. Okay, the big reason which hasn't yet come up, learning is not equal to watching videos. And a bigger reason that comes from that is learning and information are not the same. So if you capture a 1 hour lecture video and make it available, and as different students are watching the videos at different times, distance is a problem, there's no room for collaboration. It's just, you know, some student being given some information. So learning does get negatively affected here. And as some of you mentioned, engagement and attention is also, in fact, it is the first problem that will happen. Lecture video by itself is not likely to be engaging, especially because if you just capture a classroom video, it's a one-way transmission of information. Typically in 45 minutes, we give information. What happens in your class is that you may ask questions, students might ask questions and all. But if you're going to videotape it, for the learner who's sitting at a distance, it's still just a one-way transmission of information. Because of the distance, diversity and scale, this problem becomes huge. It's a mass, it's a really bad problem. And ensuring that students do the activities and these assignments. There is not much learning by doing, and even if you say I'm giving activities, how do you ensure that students are doing those activities? How do you further ensure that students are learning from them? So merely doing this, merely going, putting a camera in a classroom, capturing the lecture video and then saying, I'm going to put those together and giving assignments is not a good idea. Okay? So this comes, brings us to our zeroth principle, not even our first one. So we're calling it the content principle. A MOOC is a balanced combination of various types of learning activities using appropriate media. It's not just a collection of videos and exercises. So now that we have done some 2 hours of the session, what are the different types of learning activities that students can do in a MOOC? Just watch videos is there, some exercises is already there. In addition to these two, what are other activities?
Peering with other students.
They can do peer review, okay. Discuss with each other on some forum.
They can create some content creation.
Ask students to go and make something and create something and put it in. Somebody had a point there.
Classroom.
So discussion. Classroom discussion goes into discussion forum. So you can give part of a code and ask students to complete it. Even problems. Part of the problem can be solved, ask students to complete the problems. So this word exercise is actually, there's a lot of things in exercise. There's a lot of types of exercises, lot of creativity that you can ensure there. You can also ask the students to go find some information, find extra resources somewhere else, and then come back and do something with it. Okay, so there's a lot of learning activities that the learners can do, and correspondingly, there is also the feedback that the MOOC instructor has to somehow provide. So that is a big challenge, but you have to keep that in mind. The other point here, other phrase here, which we will come back to again, is this appropriate media. Okay. So maybe we'll hold off on this, but there is a notion that we have to use a medium that's appropriate to the task. A simple way of saying it is, don't give only text, 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 or video, 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 video. That's a simple way of, a very blunt way of saying it. Okay, now that we know we have to use balanced combination of various learning activities. Okay, we say, okay, one of those learning activities is a video. So I have to have some videos, so there will be some. So now let's look at the length. Let's focus a little bit on the length of the video. And you found some interesting video on a topic you're currently teaching. Video is 45 minutes long. You ask students to watch the video. What do you think, how long do you think students will pay attention to the video? So, less than 15 minutes, you know this. Because you watch it for? Okay, let's see what research has to say. Let me explain this graph a little bit, okay? It's very interesting. Here, this is the length of the video, 0 to 3 minutes, 3 to 6 minutes, 6 to 9 minutes, 9 to 12 minutes, and 12 to 40 minutes. And this is the percentage of students who are engaged. So the red is the median, and the blues are the extremes. Okay. So this clearly gives us a threshold. This particular graph is normalized to the video length. Okay, there was an unnormalized plot also which looked even worse. So, which means even if you give a 10-minute video, your retention is going to be sort of there till 6 minutes, 6 to 9, something starts happening and then zoom. So this is normalized, I can also put up the unnormalized graph in the final slides. Unnormalized means it's not scaled to the video length. So, student engagement while watching lecture videos is very short. And the recommendation is lecture videos greater than 10 minutes is not a good idea. So, we come to the chunking principle, which I think one of you said a few minutes ago. Don't create long lecture videos or continuous text. Chunk them. So, chunking is a technical term in education, which stands for identifying blocks of information, identifying key concepts and the information around it. So, when you have your content, this is something you have to start doing. In maybe half an hour, you'll start doing it with your own content. I'll come to example after one more. So, let's go to this slide. The recommendation is that lecture videos longer than 10 minutes are not effective. And you say, but my class is for 50 minutes, right? So, what I will do is, I will create 5 videos, each of 10 minutes long. I've been told 10 video should be only 10 minutes, and I'll ask students to watch them one after the other. Is it effective? Maybe? No? Okay. I've just put all of it together. There are 2 parts here. You can do this with your neighbor. Write down the reason why it's not effective and one possible solution to mitigate this problem. The scenario is that you give 10 videos back to back. Okay, before going to solutions, let's look at reasons why one video after another is not effective. There are many reasons. There are some very serious reasons and there are some reasons which may not have very strong implications. So, when you give a reason, we'll also look at, is it a key reason? Is it an important reason or not? We'll look at it that way. There are many reasons. So, let's see what you've discussed. Why is this giving 5 videos, short videos, one after the other, not effective? Let's take an answer from there. Yeah. No activity. So, what might go wrong if there is no activity? Okay. So, 10 videos strung back to back has very similar problems to a 50-minute video together, which is what? It's monotonous and synchronization needs to be done, I agree. But what this person did is take the 50-minute video and chop it up.
Human psychology, that human can concentrate more time on a particular topic. There should be some discussion. Then they can understand what they are thinking is right or wrong. There should be some feedback, some quizzes, so we can understand what I am thinking is right or wrong. So lots of thoughts can be came to one's mind after a certain time. So there should be a limited time lectures. After that, they are doing some activities.
Okay. So if you give 10 videos back to back, there are a few missing things. There is no opportunity for a learner to reflect on what they learned and to see if did I really understand it. That opportunity is entirely missing, which is what goes back to activity also. So we are talking of two problems here. One is engagement or boredom. Okay, it's very boring to see 5 videos back to back. So keep the boredom problem aside. The other big problem is that there is no opportunity to reflect, no feedback to the learner, no opportunity to apply their knowledge. So that's the other key reason. So let's put the two of them together. No opportunity to reflect, apply on understanding, and no feedback either. These are really the two key problems when you have one video after another. So are there reasons that go beyond these that are not encompassed in any of these?
He may feel burdened that he have to complete all those videos.
Okay.
Like it's a also human psychology. If I go to a website where different courses are there, so if some course has 15 videos and some has 25 videos, so I will go.
So they might get daunted. You're saying if they see 10 videos back to back, a lot of videos together, they might get daunted. Okay. By the way, I know many of us are from a engineering and science background. Psychology is also a science and it has its own theories and all. So let's use the word a little more technically, okay? This is sort of both our intuition and experience tells us that if I see a lot of videos together, it's daunting, right? So that is valid. So these are really the key problems. There could be other problems that my eye might get strained or I have to sort of sit and do it and all, but those are secondary.
And one
problems.
More the teacher perspective. I cannot able to assess whether the student is accumulate the knowledge from each video.
So from teacher's perspective, you have no info about learner progress, let's say, whereas in a class you might, when you ask a short question, you might see the student's answer right there. You might get some body language issues and so on. So this brings us to, so here are some strategies. Okay. The strategy issue is something we've seen many times since morning. That, and now we are addressing, there are two problems. We'll address both of them. Right now we are addressing the second problem, that there's no opportunity to reflect and apply understanding. We know that for students to be able to assimilate and apply information, the teacher has to give up lots of practice, timely practice, appropriate practice, and so on. Right? So in a MOOC setting, what we are going to do is, these are recommendations at the bottom, and then we'll come to the principle. So the recommendations are that make students do something within the video. Even within a 10-minute video, make them reflect. One of you said that, look, they want to check their understanding. Make them a quick check of understanding inside the video. And after they've done one video, make them apply it so that they can actually assimilate the information. These are the main recommendations. And this comes to what's called the sequencing principle. There are two parts to it. The first part is, says don't sequence a video after another, instead intersperse a related activity. This is for application, reflection, and so on. The second part says don't repeat the same learning activities, instead vary them frequently and sequence them. This is more to address the boredom problem or the engagement problem. So now that we've done a lot of abstract talking, thinking and all, let's look at an example. So this is an example. You're all familiar with Khan Academy, right? So I'm going to show you one 6th standard mensuration topic, areas, perimeters, rectangles and all. This is the landing page. Okay, it looks like this. And let's say we click on, so this is sort of topics and subtopics. If I click on something, let's just pause this for a moment, and I actually want to go to the lesson page. Okay, this is what the lesson page looks like. And let's go down a little. Yeah, so what is in the lesson page is there in this left bar. These are videos. This is a practice. This is another video. This is another practice, and so on. Okay, this is a standard Khan Academy module. So now let's look at our principles. Has content principle been applied? What is content principle? Okay, think about it. Has content principle been applied? And the next question here is, if not, what is missing and how to improve? So talk to your neighbor a little bit. See, so is, we're assuming that's a MOOC. So is it a balanced combination of various learning activities with appropriate media? If yes or partially yes, no, partially no, what's missing and how to improve? Come up with, what do you think? Let's see. How many of you say yes, content principle has been applied? No? Show you that. Yeah, sure. Yeah, let's say this is one module. I'll add one more point here. So there are two pages you want to see. This is the landing page. This is what it looks like. Okay. And if you go into any of the lessons, this is what it looks like. And let's add one more item to our question. Yes, no, and partially. Okay. So what's your answer? Everybody wants partially. Okay. So if you say partially, you have to answer the next question. What's missing? How to improve? Practice. Okay, let's look at the practice. This is the practice. What's the area of the figure? So many square units. I'm just going to type something. I'm going to say 4. And then I'm going to say check.
Whether he has tried the answer or really got the problem solving skill, that we will not
so able we don't know. Okay, we are going into the practice questions and we are saying that there is some problem with, or there may be a gap with the teacher understanding whether the student got it or not. Is so we will come to that. What we are asking right now is this point, that this content principle, so concentrate on this point, various learning activities. What learning activities are here?
Testing
is there, lecture, some information video is there, some practice questions are there, and some feedback is there. What's not there? Earlier when I asked you what learning activities, you said a bunch of things. There isn't much room for the student to reflect. You can say, well, there is some practice, but explicit reflection is missing. Okay,
there is no in video activity.
Yeah, we didn't watch it fully, but I think there is no in video activity. There is, if you watch the video, you will see the instructor doing an example, but in video activity is missing. If
answer is far.
So if answer is wrong, I can actually, let me see, I can try to get help. I gave a wrong answer and then I said get help. This is what it gives me. Okay, what do the instructors think, the TAs of the class? So it looks like a large number of things are there. I'm going to point out two things that you said earlier that are not here. One of you there had said peer collaboration. Okay, that seems to be missing here. And okay, so looks like content principle is more or less, this is there on the previous page, no? Yeah, here.
Just go down. There are
there is some forum also. So it looks like content principle is more or less there. Let's go to the next question. So maybe there are some things, we'll at the end of the day, we'll come back to this example. Content principle ho gaya. Then chunking principle. Yes, no? Yes, it's very clear. Chunking principle at all levels. See, what you want to look at is that this chunking principle, that's why I wanted to show you both pages. This is the landing page. It gives you chunking at a top level, and then if you go into one of these, it gives you further chunking. Small blocks of information around a key concept. And the next question is sequencing principle applied. Sequencing principle says that don't give video, or just text. Yes, how do you know? Some practice questions are there. Okay, so now let's come to our LCM MOOC. So anytime you see a blue putty here, it's like the elements of a MOOC. This is what you'll need to start creating and thinking. So how do content principle, chunking and sequencing principle, how do they inform the LCM MOOC that you are going to create? This is your main takeaway slide again. You'll need to create LEDs. What is a LED? Stands for a learning dialogue. And a learning dialogue is a short content, video or text with a reflection spot in between. You'll need to create learning by doing activities, which are some questions, some exercises, plus customized feedback. You saw some customized feedback, no? You can get help if you want. You can go to the next question if you want. You can do 7 more problems if you want. And sequence one learning by doing activity after every learning dialogue video. So when you start planning your MOOC, this is now when we'll actually start planning your MOOC, up to a certain point. What we will do here is start with the materials of your own course or syllabus that you've brought. So I think this is the time to take it out. And the goals are, first we'll do some scoping. First you'll do some scoping and then you'll start applying these principles.
Yeah, so what we are going to do now is, all of you have your own lesson course plans with you. So we'll start off trying to move from a course to a MOOC. So we'll follow the scoping, then chunking, sequencing, then we'll move to the other principles as and when it comes. So let me show you a sample worksheet. So for the time being, you can do it in your own notepad. We'll provide you the worksheets where you can work it out later. So this is a worksheet for planning a learner-centric MOOC. This resource, the worksheet, will be provided to you, and it is in CC by SA. So you can see the sequence of planning, it goes in this format. First you will scope, then you will plan the materials, then you will do the chunking, then sequencing, then you will look for feedback, and finally assessment. So text written in black are generally instructions, explanations or recommendations that we provide. Text written in orange are the guiding questions. Blue needs to be replaced with participants' input. So wherever you see a blue, that is the thing that you will have to write. We'll later add the aligned learner-centric MOOC principles. This will be there in the final worksheet. This will be shared with everyone so that you can use it when you go home. Okay, so first is the scoping exercise. The guiding question or the guiding objective is, what portion of your course can be converted into a MOOC, and what will be the dominant characteristics of the learners in this MOOC? So for this activity, it can be a group activity in class, but when you go home, it should be an individual activity. Yeah, individual activity. Yeah, for the workshop, it is a group activity. So you can, so this is why now you can sit together with your neighbor and start thinking of this. So the first thing in this is the course that you want to put as a MOOC. Again, recommendation, it is desirable that you have taught this course more than once. Just because only when you teach a course, you will understand what all are the difficulties the learners will face while learning this course. So you will have to have at least one or two runs of this course in a face-to-face setting to efficiently convert it into a MOOC. For the worksheet, we are thinking of, we are just putting a cap. It is a 4 weeks online course. This 4 weeks will include student practice and assessment. So first, after deciding the course, you will have to decide topics, 3 or 4 topics that are there in this course, which can be covered in this 4 weeks. Again, note, since this is in an online mode, the calculations for a face-to-face setting will not work here. So typically what we have seen is that 1 week of face-to-face instruction, that means 3 lectures, practice, assessments and everything, will be more than 2 weeks in an online setting. So you will have to figure that in mind while deciding the topics. Typical learning hours could be 6 to 8 hours of learner time. So the question that has been asked is, what is the learner time? I'll just note over here, this is 6 to 8 hours of learning time.
Per week.
So once you have decided the topics, the next is identifying the learner characteristics. So what will be the primary characteristics of the learner? So it could be the age group, the domain, it could be their prior experience on that particular course, etc. And now that you have thought about the learner characteristics, put down all the prerequisites that you have. Now to help you in doing this, there are 2 recommendations. It is desirable to start by identifying the learner or learner characteristic that you are not addressing. Think of all the people who are outside the purview of the course. So for example, there is an electrical teacher. He is going to take a course on design of power transmission structures. Clearly, this teacher do not want any arts or management students who do not have the basic prerequisites for understanding power transmission, what are involved in power transmission structures and other designs. Next, for learners who are nearly aligned to the characteristics, you can provide essential skills that need to be attained before the start of the course. So, suppose you are doing a computer science course. So, over here there is a educational data analytics course. I want to teach educational data analytics. But to completely do this course, the learner who comes in need to have some skills in programming. So, here I have put in skills in Python and in a particular database called MongoDB, because that is what I will extensively use in this course. So, if the learner is not familiar with this, they have come to terms with these particular whatever are the skills. So, you can suggest some other courses or some reference materials that they have to go through before start of the course. So, finally, it's the learning objectives for the topics. So, you would have identified 4 or 5 topics. You will have to write the learning objectives only for 2 topics. You can identify more than 2 or less than 2, but at least for 2 you will have to write the learning objective. So, why don't we start the activity now? Pair up. First, decide on a course that the pair will convert into a MOOC. So, you can use your lesson plans, share your lesson plans, the course plan that you have brought in, and then decide on a course that you would want to take forward as a MOOC.
So we can actually spread out a little bit.
Yeah.
In the room, and then the TAs can also kind of move around and provide any help that we require.
So, all of you please note that this is a 4 weeks online course, 1 week equivalent to 6 to 8 hours of learner's time. So, 6 to 8 hours of learning time, it will have all the activities. So choose your course and topic based on this criteria. One team can have 2 to 3 members. You can group together and decide on a course that you would, that your peer is also comfortable with. Okay, everyone, just listen. So this topic, so a course like all of you are familiar with IIT Bombay's structure, right? So it will have a left hand side modules and right hand side elements. So what is going to happen in this workshop is you will together decide about a left hand side of the course today, and tomorrow you will work on one element of this. So there is no problem even if you are not working on this topic that you have brought along with you. So all you are doing is you will identify the modules for a course inside the workshop. Yeah, how many modules should be there? What should be the subtopics in this particular modules? And you will work on one element each. So how will you do one video? How will you do one practice activity? How will you do one discussion? How will you do one additional reference? This is all what you will do in the workshop. So it's a just a hands-on on what you will do for one minute activity. So the entire MOOC process, one snapshot will be done in the workshop. Yes, this is a practice only for the larger MOOC design. And once you understand this process, you can apply it in your own setting and try to do for your own course. So there is no problem if you are not working on a subject that you have brought along with you, or no problem if the subject, you think that the subject is too theoretical. You are not going to design the entire course. I mean, you are not going to create the entire course in the workshop. You will think of the entire course, but you will look into individual elements.
Now here there is an important clarification I want to make. You have to go above your domains at times. See, here we are talking about MOOCifying your ideas. So all of us are like our teaching assistants who are roaming around to help you out are not possibly experts of each and every domain. I am the most outlier here because I come from fine arts. So is there no chance that I can talk somebody who is making a geography course or a mathematics course? These subjects I left when I was in 10th. Okay, but that doesn't mean that it should not be kind of a scenario where I cannot participate. So think as an instructor, don't think as a mathematics instructor, don't think as a networking instructor, to be very specific. Don't go into that silos mode. Unless you come out of that silos and then think yourself as a MOOC instructor, you will not be able to impart anything to each other. So first and foremost, think yourself only as an instructor, that's all, first. And second is, whenever you come out as an instructor and then you start talking about feasibilities of whether this is in scope, out scope, or you can add more objectives to it or something like that, then it will be mutually beneficial. That is first part. The second, which I was not saying for a long time, but we discussed it out, there is always a possibility that if you complete your partner's ideas of what MOOC is, and if you have time, you can always do the role reversal and do your course also at the end of the day. We have enough time for that. So you can do the role reversal and get your ideas also across, because that will also give you insights about whether you had thought it properly or not. So please take it up as a instructor to instructor talk, not as a geography teacher talking to a maths teacher. Are we clear about it?
Yeah, so for doing this particular activity, you do not require internet. It is your understanding and you are bringing in your prior knowledge. All prior knowledge and argumenting with your peer. And either get convinced or get your peer convinced.
And therefore, important point is, there should be no team with a single participant. That is not possible. So please team up with somebody, whether in your subject, not possible for that subject, but no team with a single participant.
Yeah.
Fine. Okay. Now, what is the call you can take when you want to MOOCify this? What is your now in terms of your timeline estimation in a MOOC? How will you calculate this?
It will be approximately 14 hours. 14 hours, as per the instruction given here, 1 week of face-to-face instruction equal to 2 weeks.
Okay. Why we are saying it 1 is equal to 2? It is because it is not just lectures, there are activities, right? Even in a class, when you give a lecture and go away, you give some homework and people will solve it at home, or they will do it in the class, eating up your lecture time, or they will do it after hours, right? So this is another additional material. They will have a lab, they may have experiment time and all that. So just calculating that number is not good enough. Therefore, we have to calculate it at the double side. Now, when we come to that level, then you can think of that you cannot just match. So this mistake should not be done, that you just copy the number of hours in your lesson plan and exactly make it available at the MOOC timing, because there will be additional work. Therefore, in the slides what JK was showing, he was saying that so 2 week online instruction is 6 to 8 hours of learning time per week. Now please don't mistake this learning time for video lecture time. Okay, learning time will include watching a video, learning from the video, repeating a video if required, looking at it multiple times, solving the corresponding activities on that, asking problems about that activity on a discussion forum, waiting for the reply, getting a reply and reflecting on it. All that will cover into this hours. So there are times when a MOOC learner puts up a request, I did not understand this thing, and they may not get an instantaneous reply because there are no chat bots on the other side. There are physical people who have to write answer. So they will write maybe after 3 hours. In between, this person is so worried about the question, he or she may keep on visiting that MOOC site to see whether I have got the answer or not. So that is all, the time has gone for that person, which doesn't happen in a regular class. In a regular class, I raise a hand, I get an answer. Maximum I get an answer that I will get answer tomorrow. At least I will get that much. So I don't have to think about it till the tomorrow's class comes up. But here, this time is also has to be estimated. That is called as learning time. So all this will form your estimation theory. Like how much time are you going to give that? So in order to do that, keep your scope narrower. That is what I am saying. So don't go for a huge list of objectives.
This activity, it will continue today till end of it. Tomorrow you will take a specific activity. You don't have to submit your answer sheets with us. We'll come over and we'll get your answers, elicit answers from you. The entire exercise is for across the 2 days, you will complete the entire worksheets or a series of worksheets and you will take it along with you. So do not worry about when to submit all those submission due dates. So this is a workshop without due dates. Okay. Term is recurring. By learner characteristics and prerequisites, what we mean is learner characteristics are the skills and competencies that the learner will bring in. So it is not the degree that the learner brings in. Okay. So how will you know that this guy is actually, let's say, BTech first year? What is the proof that this is a BTech first year? And how many of you believe that a BTech first year will actually be doing all this? So it is the skills and competencies that are required to target the course. So you will have some objectives, broad objectives in mind. So the learners, so the learner characteristics. So that is the learner characteristics. And the prerequisites is, okay, if you have done such and such course, that is a prerequisite. Or you have used a particular book, you have gone through all the examples in a particular book, or let's say you have designed a website. All these are prerequisites. So for example, how to design a website using HTML and CSS, that could be a prerequisite for an advanced web development course. So the participant should have developed some website on their own. So that is a prerequisite.